Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Dave Creutzfeldt, Mayor of Oskaloosa, and I'll be moderating Eggs and Issues this morning. I want to say a special thank you to Smokey Row for providing the venue for this Eggs and Issues. Would also like to acknowledge and thank Midwest One for providing the coffee this morning. We also want to especially acknowledge that we have the reporting that's going to be going on of this event. We have the Oski News here, the Oskaloosa Herald, KBOE Radio, KIIC Radio, the New Sharon Sun, and CRI. And our panel, of course, we want to make sure we recognize them as well. We have School Superintendent Russ Ryder, School Board President Tom Richardson, and then also Principal Elementary Principal Mike Dursky, who will be here. And so as we do usually, we'll offer them the opportunity to offer some opening comments. And then as we proceed with the event, if you have any questions or comments you'd like to make, please come up here up front where we can see you. I'll hold the mic in my hand to make sure that we get the sound captured and everybody has a chance to hear what's being said. And as a courtesy, we do ask that people say where they're from. If they are from Oskaloosa, that's good enough. But if they're from out of town, it's nice to know that that perspective is being presented. Gentlemen, any opening comments?
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for being here this morning. If there's any time that you can't hear us in the back because we don't have the microphone close enough, please raise your hand and let us know. On behalf of the school board, the administrators, and the staff in Oskaloosa, I'd like to just thank everybody for being here this morning. Margaret Radcliffe, I think, contacted me a couple months ago, and she said, what would happen if maybe at the very end of the season for our Eggs and Issues, we allowed the school an opportunity to have some conversations with the public, and we thought it was a very intriguing idea. And so with that, we decided, yeah, let's go ahead and do that. We got a lot of positive things that are going on in our district. We want to share those, and yet we also want to be as transparent as we can and allow you, the public, an opportunity to ask us questions. So I'm going to go ahead and pass this over to Mr. Dursky, and he may make a few statements, and then Mr. Richardson, and then I'll probably just finish up, and then we'll get to our questions.
Well, this morning I get a chance to do two things that I love. One is, and I see a lot of familiar faces, so everybody that knows me will know I love to talk, and I love to talk about school, so this is a great venue for that. And I am going to talk a little bit about some of the celebrations and the great things that are going on at the elementary school. But please know that it's not just me. I work with 150 great people every single day. And as I go through our successes and our celebrations, I will probably reference some of those, and I'm going to refer to my notes just so that I am as accurate as possible when I go through that today. But I'm going to let Mr. Richardson talk and welcome everybody, but thank you for being here and putting up with me this morning.
All right. Thanks, Mike. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. I want to thank Smokey Row and our media for taking part in this event. Again, my name's Tom Richardson. I've been on the school board for 6 years now. The past 2 years have been honored to serve as the board president. On a personal side, my wife and I have two kids in the district, a seventh grader at middle school, a freshman at our high school, so we have skin in the game. I'm very proud that my kids attend the Oskaloosa School District and very glad to talk with all of you today.
So since I'm a former history teacher, the historical perspective is I started for the district in 1989-90 school year, and what our elementary day looked like at Garfield School while I started then and what it looks like now is a lot different. And so our elementary school continues to evolve and change each year to meet the needs of our students and our community. Some of our celebrations right now are test scores, and this was reported at the board recently, but regionally in our AEA region and statewide, our reading scores are currently at or above the state and regional level, and so everybody's really excited about that. That's great news, and that's our kindergarten through fifth grade. We regularly monitor all of our children's reading progress. And we have a lot of reading strategies and interventions in place to work with all of our students, whether you're a struggling reader or an advanced reader. We have small intervention groups that meet for 15 minutes with specific skills. We have AmeriCorps reading tutors that work in our building. We have Title I services along with special ed services, all that work with those children each and every day. We have an increasing diversity at the elementary school, and part of that is we have a very mobile group. We have an influx of students and families in and out, and from our second day of school through yesterday, we have had 96 children that have been in and out of the school. Now, another part of that, or a component of that, is that some of those children, not represented in that 96, is we have a couple families that have been back and forth several times. So they may leave for a while, come back, leave for a while, come back. The reasons for that are there's 96 kids involved, and there's 96 different reasons. For some of it, it might be employment. Some of it might be housing. Some of those are foster families. But we have a fluid number of kids, and each and every time one of those children enter our room, that's a new pecking order that needs to be established, and those kids, we need to make them feel welcome. How we receive them is very important in work with those families, but that changes the dynamic of the entire building each and every time those kids come in. On Monday alone, our first day back from spring break, we had 17 families that were in and out of the elementary school. 17 kids that were in and out of the elementary school alone. So when I went back to work, I always have a list of the things that I want to do and get done. But I was not expecting 17 children to be in and out of the office on that one day. And again, that's not just me. That's Lisa Brown at our central office, our district registrar, our secretaries, Mr. Vaseth, our 3-5 principal, Mrs. Liebel, the K-2 principal, who help every day to place children in those classrooms. We work closely with our Area Education Association, and we have two on-site AEA reps that work with us, and we have to find out, do those children have IEPs? What special needs do they have? And put all those things into place. So getting lunches lined up, it's a big process, and we had that many just in one day. Last year we spent a lot of time last year and this year working on behavior situations at the elementary school, and we continue to work with our PBIS process. And again, at our board meetings, we've reported this regularly, 90% of the students at the elementary school, which is over 1,000 kids, have had one or less disciplinary referral to the office. We have 7%, roughly somewhere around there, that have been to the office 2 to 6 times. And I'm proud of those numbers. I think that's good. Recently, the school is working with Rosie Warden, I think that's Warder, who's originally from Oskaloosa. She will start working with us on the Dubuque management system. And she said anytime that you're above 80%, that's a really a success. So we operate at 90% or above. All of our behaviors are tracked, and so we know if it's a incident on the playground, in the classroom, in the hallway, in the lunchroom. We have small groups that work and meet regularly with those students. We have a dean of students, Mr. Trainer, kind of a behavior clinician that works with those students in small groups, along with our guidance counselors. We have check-in, check-out systems. We have daily communication with those parents. Again, some of them working with the AEA, and then outside counseling resources as well. And I think that we have a real good line of communication and feel positive about the work we do with those families and parents. A new addition to the elementary school in the next couple months, which the middle school has been a part of, is we will be hosting some 15 Chinese students the end of April and the first of May, and they will be in our building for about 5 or 6 days. So we'll be looking for host families and activities for those children while they're here. Some numbers about the school. This is our 11th year, and I'm always amazed at the people that I talk to that don't know about the size and the scale, or the economy of scale in that building. We have around 92 licensed staff at the elementary. We have around 40 associates. And we have our food service ladies. They prepare breakfast for around 300 children each day. 4 years ago, we started out with about 100 children eating breakfast, and then we're at around 300 each day. We've also partnered with several churches in the community to help out with that, and so Central Reformed Church has been great this year to provide the elementary school with about 5 or 6 people to just come sit with the kids, get to know the kids, talk to them, and help supervise, but mostly build that relationship with those children each and every day. The Methodist Church has helped with a reading program, and also during parent-teacher conferences, provided a child care system so that parents could attend their conference and their other children could be watched in the library and read to during that time. We've also had a lot of support from churches providing us with hats and gloves and mittens and boots and all those essential items for our children to attend recess. We work with William Penn and Central College each year. We have student teachers and a lot of people that come to do observation hours and practicum hours. We continue to work with our local police department and offer the drug abuse resistance education program. And Lieutenant Alexander works there. He also helps us with school security issues. The last couple of years I've been there, Chief Neff from the fire department has also been instrumental in coming out and help. We added a buzz-in security system, and we've changed some other security issues at the elementary school the last number of years, just keeping up with the times. We will have our fourth year this year of summer school. Summer school's looked a little bit different each year as we continue to refine and work through that and the kids that we work with. We've partnered with the YMCA in the past with that. What it's gonna look like this year, we're not sure. We're working out those details. We've also partnered with United Way the last number of years so that the elementary school could provide breakfast and lunch to those children that attend the summer reading program. And we also are a meals site the last number of years for that in the summer as well. We still continue to have 100 students participate in band and 100 students participate in orchestra each week. We also have a partnership with the YMCA Head Start and CETA that's housed in the Webster Building, and we have 2 classrooms over there for 3- and 4-year-old children. And I guess I would just conclude with my opening statement of what my day looked like and how our schedule was in 1989 compared to what our schedule looks like and our day looks like in 2017 is a lot different, and we continue to evolve, follow that model of continuous improvement at the elementary school. Please know you can always stop in and visit with Jolene, Tim, or myself. Call, email, we are happy to work with you, sit down with you, and I would think that from the people that are around here that I know that have stopped in the office, I think they would confirm that to be true. And with that, thank you. If you have any questions at that time, when everybody else is done, please ask.
Okay, thanks, Mike. I'd like to share a few positives from the district-wide, the big picture that the board looks at. And I should say, like a lot of school boards, we may not always agree on some topics. You'll see that if you ever watch our meetings. But one thing I think all board members would agree to is we always want the best for Oskaloosa's kids. We're going to share our opinions. We're going to discuss items. But we're always looking for what's best for the kids of Oskaloosa. We want a real well-rounded education for all kids. This is a public school district. We're going to serve all kids that enter our doors the best that we can. A couple items within the buildings, within the elementary. Mr. Dursky mentioned our progress on reading scores as of late. The math, science, all other areas of their education also extremely important to us, and we have things in place for that we're updated on regularly. Another item that I want to mention on the middle school side, statewide, it's been pretty common for some years when students go to their first year of middle school that there's a dip in their test scores. It's a big change. They're changing classes. They're a little bit older than they were in elementary and working and exchanging with older kids now. And a change was made in our middle school structure for sixth grade and how their schedule was put together and how many different teachers they have for certain subjects within the math and reading and things of that nature. So for the test scores for this past year, when we had the IO assessments for these sixth graders, we did not see that big drop that we saw. We're very happy with that. That's something we want to build on with other ideas and changes that could be made to make it an even better experience for those kids when they enter middle school. Within the high school, there's been some other very positives I'd like to share. We made a change in the high school schedule about a year and a half ago, something that the teachers approached the board with. If we could have the end of the day have a time set aside for those students who are struggling with certain subjects that could use additional contact time with a math or science teacher, whatever the subject would be, that could make a big difference in how they are doing in their classes. And we're very happy to report that we have the fewest number of Fs in the high school as we've had in the past 8 years. As long as our principal, Mr. Bandy's been there, that this is the best improvement we've seen in that score. So that's something awesome, especially he pointed out in the number of freshmen that are scoring Fs. Big improvement there, and that's getting them off to a good start. We want all of our kids to be successful in high school and striving for graduation. I also want to mention another unique thing about our high school. We have a building trades class. If you drive on South H Street or over near Webster, you'll see houses that our high school students have built. There's a lot of school districts that have had to drop that program. This is something that involves a lot of kids, not only doing the construction, but also the interior design. I've sat in on classes with those kids where they're putting up presentations on how we're going to have the flooring, the kitchen cabinets, the paint color, all of those things. So it's really involving kids in many different areas in the school for all aspects of that house being constructed. Also very happy about all the college level classes that our students can access in our high school. I spent yesterday pretty much the entire day in our high school visiting different class periods. I spoke with one student who will graduate in 2 months, and their first day when they step on campus in college, they'll already be a sophomore. I think that's wonderful. We have those opportunities for kids to get those classes in now and get them off to a good start in college. We want our kids in Oskaloosa to have as many opportunities to learn and grow as possible. A few good examples of that, we have a robotics club. You'll read about them in our media sometimes in the events that take part in. Not only do they compete on the state level, but in many years they compete at the world championships in St. Louis, Missouri, and represent Oskaloosa very well, so very proud of that fact. We have one of the finest orchestra programs in the state. Very proud of that program, and those kids work very hard. You've seen them perform at the state capitol, I believe, one day each winter at that. And also another item I'll mention, our jazz band going to state again, as they have in the past, and we've had other good successes this past year. Our softball team, state champions, our boys basketball and football team also had a very, very good season representing our school very well. Few items, again, from the district-wide, we have a one-to-one computer program for all kids in the high school. They all have a laptop computer. All kids in our middle school have a laptop computer. In our elementary,
Third through fifth
have a computer, but I believe in the younger grades, they have laptops in the room. So we have a lab that's available for kids. So we have I think it was last year we purchased about 1,800 Chromebooks in addition to what the middle school already had. We're not using general fund dollars to do that. We're not using property tax dollars to do that. We're using the 1% sales tax, which is allowed by the state to purchase technology. So thank you, Oskaloosa, for doing your local shopping so we can use those funds to buy computers for all the kids in our buildings. We have a school bus fleet of about 35 buses. We've made changes recently to make the average age of that fleet much less, again, for safety reasons. We've added cameras, three safety security cameras in all of the buses so we can monitor what's going on, again, to keep kids safe. Last item I'll mention is that our school district is now debt-free. By the use of the 1% sales tax, we've paid off the elementary building, we've paid off the high school addition that was done some years ago. Not an impact on property taxes. Thank you, Oskaloosa, for your shopping locally so we can use those tax dollars to pay for those projects and not use our general fund or our property tax funding to pay for those buildings.
Looking at the time, I could talk for the next 35 minutes and we'd be done at 8:30 or 9:30 and we'd be out of here. That'd be good. No questions to worry about. I'm just going to mention a couple of different things and we'll open it up to the group here. The one thing I believe that probably we're most proud about, and I'm very proud about, is the continued relationships we're having with our local businesses and those individuals who we can share programs with, projects with. We get a lot of great support from our companies and businesses here in town, and I hate to mention one or two or three because I'm probably going to leave somebody out, but we do have some great things going on, especially at the high school, where we have some students going into businesses and working with those businesses and helping them out through what we call the Iowa Quality Center. It's a great program, and I hope you get a chance to read about some of those fantastic things, real-world learning opportunities for our kids. There's so many good things that are taking place, and ultimately, you've got to step back and say, why are these happening? And it is the leadership of the board, but ultimately, you've got to take a look at those teachers in the classroom. Those teachers that are doing some outstanding things and working hard. And you know, a lot of us in the educational world, we do get criticized once in a while. But the amount of hours these people put in, not only just for that day of whether it's an 8 to 4, it's about the meetings after school. It's about what they're doing at night to prepare themselves for the next day. They're dedicated, and you can see that take place in the classroom. Probably the one thing that is changing our world right now in the educational arena has to be what has transpired here recently in the legislature with the Chapter 20. No doubt about it. It's got everybody, including me and our board. It's one of those issues where you've got to step back, kind of take a deep breath and say, all right, how is this going to impact our students here within the community? How's it going to impact our families? And all I can tell you at this point is we're working. We're working to do everything we possibly can. We know there's going to be changes. The collective bargaining bill that was passed is going to impact us in some way. And ultimately, it's going to impact every district across the state. Now, some districts were able to and decided to sign a 1 or 2 year deal. Probably half the districts across the state did not do that. We understand that that's going to have a dramatic effect on not only people's emotions, but ultimately the board is going to do what they can to put the priorities of student education, taking care of our employees, and hopefully we can continue to move on in a very positive way. Financially, for the district, we're holding our own. We've had to do a lot of things over the last, at least the 7 years that I've been here. We've probably have averaged 1.75% new money, and that 1.75% or 1.8, whatever, it's pretty close to that. Slightly under 2, You're only going to get that new money if you actually have the same enrollment and or increased enrollment. For districts like ours that have had just a slow slide, you may not get that. There have been many years where we've only had the same amount of money that we did last year for our regular program, for educating our regular ed programs. So that's something that we've had to deal with. We've had to make a lot of changes in some of the things on how we do business. There's still the issue about testing around the state. Do we stay with the Iowa assessments, or do we take on that new test called the Smarter Balance, which is probably going to be a little bit more strenuous? And I'm not scared of that. I'm not afraid of that. I'd like to see our state go to a more demanding test. But of course, then we can all expect our test scores to go down a little bit because our students are not used to that type of test where there's a lot more critical thinking, and it's just not filling in a bubble, guessing potentially on the 3 or 4 multiple choice questions. So there's a lot more to that test. Outside of some of the other things that these gentlemen have talked about, very proud of the school year we've had, all the activities, the successes we've seen, what's happened within the classroom, activities, sports, band, vocal music, drama. There are so many good things happening, and really, I guess, from that perspective, my time's up. I'm going to go ahead and just give this back to Mayor Dave, and we'll start taking questions.
Okay. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Okay, first question.
Hi, my name's Diane Crookham Johnson. I'm here today as a citizen and as a parent of a student in our district. I am not here on behalf of the State Board of Education. They would ask me to make it very clear that I'm not representing them today. My question is for Mr. Ryder. I really appreciated one of your very early comments that you're all about transparency. And there's a lot happening in our district right now. I think all of you addressed so many of those issues that are causing a lot of turmoil and stress. Frequently, I hear from teachers and school board members that they're not able to openly communicate with each other. Even that sometimes if a board member approaches a teacher and says, "Can you give me some feedback on this issue?" Teacher's response is, "We're told we have a chain of command for communication in our district and we can't talk to you." Can you reassure all the teachers in the room today that based on our belief that transparency is important, that they can talk to school board members whenever they'd like?
Well, I can't necessarily say yes to the final question, but I will say we have a board policy, and right off the top of my head, I can't remember the actual number of that board policy, but it does state in there that when teachers have an issue, we ask them first to go to their building principal. When parents have an issue, we ask them to go first to the teacher. Sometimes when teachers have an issue and they go right over a principal, or myself as a superintendent, or a curriculum director, or any other administrator, and they go right to a board member, they're talking to this board member, they come back to me, and they'll say, did you know this was happening, or what's going on here? And I'm like, I haven't heard of that, I don't know. So if, in fact, they go through that chain of command where they talk to their building principal, they talk to the curriculum director, they talk to me, or they, we can have an opportunity to sit down and work something out, and at least I know what's happening, then it goes to the school board member. I have no problem with that because I think we all need to know. Where my frustrations have been in the past is where teachers, parents, they go directly to a board member, then they come back to me. That's not how any type of system is supposed to operate, whether it's in business or whether it's in our Board of Education and the community. We like them to go through that chain of command. Once everybody is notified, then the issue of going directly from a teacher to the board, and it just circumvents that system, which makes it very difficult to communicate. I would just assume if they have the issue, we've gone through the proper chain, then we can bring people together and have and try to solve that problem.
And actually, I think part of my question was if the school board member is approaching the teacher. If you want to use the business model, I think the prime example would be a board of directors at a business that walk up to an employee in that business and say, "How are things going?" You would always expect that that employee could talk to the board of directors. Why is it that when school board members approach teachers, teachers can't talk to the school board member?
Well, again, I don't have a problem with board members going in having casual conversation. going to a classroom. Mr. Richardson had spent all day yesterday in classrooms, coming back to me and saying, hey, you know, I saw some great things happening. But if there are complaints, like I think in any business, in order to solve those complaints, everybody needs to know about them. And sometimes, right or wrong, I'm one of the last ones to find out about it or about a specific issue, and I would like to at least know what's happening so we can work out the issue. Okay? Thank you, Diane. Good question.
Hello, my name is Mary Shoblem Hersom. First, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to speak with you at an open forum. I'm very passionate and a little nervous about speaking today. Next, by the turnout of people that have attended, I think it's clear that many people are interested in what you have to say. 20 years ago, I signed a contract and made a commitment to the Oskaloosa Community School District and to the families of Oskaloosa to do my best to provide education for their children. I have worked with 3 superintendents, 15 principals, and hundreds of families. I've dedicated myself to going above and beyond to provide for my students and their families. It's always been my belief that our actions speak louder than our words. I'd like to share just a couple examples before my questions. First, I said I'm committed to going above and beyond for my students. How do I demonstrate this? I work on things early in the morning, late at night, and on weekends. There have been times when I've been sick, but I've come into work because I knew our district did not have enough subs and it would provide a hardship. But don't take my word for it. You can look up my attendance record. I have 120 sick days, the maximum that our district allows. And each year, my new sick days are just thrown away. Most years, I carry over my personal days into the next year. And you may ask, why do I do this? Because again, my actions speak louder than my words. I am demonstrating my commitment to what is best for our students. When our student scores were not where we felt that they should be, did I sit back and complain or blame others? Nope. Rolled up my sleeves and worked harder because I'm committed to doing what is best for our students in our district. I am excited and very proud that our FAST scores at the elementary have gone up, and we are above both the state and the area scores. 3 years ago, we enrolled our son into this district. I believe that demonstrates a personal commitment to this district. I didn't look around to see what other schools were scoring. I stayed here, and as a parent and an educator, I am sharing that I have a personal commitment. I've always tried to be a team player, and I've always tried to provide a positive spark and one that motivates others, because I believe it does make a difference. But I am seeing a change in the culture and the morale of our school, a change that has started at the top. When the state passed Chapter 20, it changed how the superintendent and the board could negotiate with our employees. While many schools around us worked together to sign contracts that would ensure their school would maintain their staff and that the staff would feel secure in their jobs, Superintendent Ryder and our board would not meet with our staff. Our staff tried multiple times in November, December, January, and February to meet. Our staff is worried about what Superintendent Ryder and the board are planning to do. By your actions or your lack of actions, we are losing trust that you want to work together with us as a team for our families. When Mr. Ryder spoke to our staff on February 17th, he explained that although the board appreciates...
Okay. Thank you, Mary. You're exactly right with regards to the amount of hours and time our staff puts in, no doubt about that. You made a comment that the association had contacted me and started back in November, December, January, and as have contacted me to start. The entire process by which we negotiate, get and file those initial letters was very much standard from November and all the way through January. Not much else was different. I can't say that the union called me once a week and said, hey, we want to meet. And I'm not going to sit here and belabor all the things. You and I are going to differ on how many times I was contacted. I can tell you I was contacted on a Sunday afternoon the week before the governor was going to sign that bill. And hey, can we go ahead and meet? How many more times than that? I'd have to go back and check because there weren't that many. And but I'll stop that there. You are committed. The staff is committed. I guess from my perspective, we all have our positions, we all have our responsibilities. Part of my responsibility is the fiduciary responsibility and the fiscal responsibility to keep the district above water. How are we committed as a board, as a superintendent? Over the last 7 years, last 6 years, we have handed out settlements of 3.26, 3.25, 3.7, 3.7, 3.01, and 3.08. The amount of new money our district received, negative 1.5, 1%, 2.8, 1.6, 1.7, negative 0.3, and 1%. Every year, when you deal with the budget the size of ours, every year we have to determine how do we prioritize education for kids. There's only so much money. And when we're handing out dollars to meet the negotiation obligation, something has to give. And in the past, that have been jobs. That has been teachers. We have lost certified staff members through attrition, and we have not hired back. There comes a point that we would love to continue handing out 3%, 3.5% increases in raise and insurance and salary, but how do we continue to keep the programs we have?
Have in each of those years that we haven't received plus money, did you also receive an increase?
As a superintendent, absolutely, except for last year. I voluntarily froze my salary last year. Nobody else, I don't believe, did. No one came to me and said, hey, there are difficult times. No other administrator, no other teacher, nobody else in the district came to me and said, let me volunteer a freeze in my salary. I told the board I wasn't going to accept one. Maybe I should have, I don't know. All I can tell you is we have decisions at the top that we have to look. It's not about whether we value our staff. We do. We got a tremendous staff. But we also want our kids to have the best programs. I don't want to have to cut a building trades program. I don't want to have to cut an orchestra program. I don't want to have to cut all the, quote, the non-core items. And so with that, at some point, we have to decide. We've gone from... we have an at-risk program, but how many dollars do we have that can help that? And if we have to cut individuals who are helping that at-risk program, now all of a sudden we have more difficulties. Who's there to handle those students who are having behavior issues and students who are threatening to drop out? All right? And so I can say, trust me, I know that's going to be very difficult to do. All right? Because we have tried, I met with some individuals Thursday after school and we tried to talk about all the things that we've done to try and free up general fund money. All the money we're spending in other categories and areas so that we can try to find anywhere from $500,000 to $600,000 a year to help pay and offset the dollars that we know are gonna go for certified staff increases as well as support staff increases. And when you're only getting potentially on average 1.75% new from the state, everybody who owns a home and has a family, you can't continue to spend more money than you're bringing in without making cuts. And we've cut secretaries, we've cut custodians, we've cut support staff almost to a bare minimum, and we're very, very thin. I would like to restore 4 to 5 positions, two reading positions at the middle school, a high school position, and a position at the elementary. None of that can happen, because we have lost a number of certified staff positions over the last 7 to 8 years. So I truly appreciate your comments, because you're an outstanding teacher, you work extremely hard. But our commitment at this particular level has to be seen and balanced by not only showing our 100% support behind the staff, but also 100% support behind kids and programs and how do we educate those kids. So I do appreciate your comments and thank you. Tom, did you want to make?
Sure, I just want to add to that myself, I put together my own list of board goals for myself, and I think it would be in line with what other board members would say. Our first priority has to be for the kids of Oskaloosa. A very close second is that we take care of our employees. priorities 3 through 10 are going to be much lower down the line. I appreciate all the work the teachers do. I've been volunteering in classrooms for my 6 years. I know they're in the trenches. They're working with these kids every day on so many different things. It's in the financial situation. I've been to Eggs and Issues virtually every time for the past 6 years. I've talked to our representatives. I haven't made a lot of progress there in what I would like to see, but I understand they're doing their job. I've mentioned in the past at Eggs and Issues that we don't have any more pennies to pinch. I appreciate the work our school business manager, our superintendent, our principals have done in the past, finding, like Mr. Ryder said, $500,000, $600,000 a year in different areas. That low-hanging fruit has all been taken up. Last year, we made a change in our high school schedule to where we would be an eight-period day so we could have the same classes offered to kids, potentially with fewer staff if that was necessary, or giving us the opportunity to share staff between the middle school and the high school. We're trying to have all those options available to our district where we can take care of the kids' needs and in the world of finance that we live in with potentially fewer people if that's the case. I don't want to see those cuts mentioned that Mr. Ryder said either. You've probably seen in the media this past year a lot on school behavior. We've made some great improvements there. It's not perfect. We're meeting next Tuesday to do more follow-up on that. But I don't want to make changes that are going to take us a step backwards there. The reading scores in the elementary, Mr. Dursky talked about. I want to see that continue. I don't want to see cuts made that could make that go back. 80% of our general fund expenses are for teacher salaries, I should say staff salaries and benefits. So when it comes to making these types of financial decisions, the thing that's the biggest impact is if you have to make staff reductions or layoffs. I don't want to lay off anyone. One thing that's different about Oskaloosa from all these other districts that may have settled, and it's just reality, for many years through the negotiations, the health insurance for the family coverage has been at no cost to the employee. That's something that other districts generally don't do. We've had, I believe there's about 7 school districts in Iowa that offer the family coverage for employees at no cost. This is a big expense. We needed time to contact our suppliers. Is there advantages to have different tiered systems on the benefits, I'm sorry, on the coverage, on the plans? Are there different deductibles that we can look at where the school can take on some of that risk that can lower the premium so we can reduce money, we can offer a good health insurance plan to all employees, but with a smaller amount of money coming in from the state, we have to be able to take care of the student needs that we've mentioned thus far without cutting anything. So our focus is on the students, our focus is on the teachers, the staff as well, but we have to be maintaining all those things necessary for our kids.
Hi, my name is Mary Rand, and I'm from Oskaloosa also. This has been very informative today, and I've appreciated everybody's questions. The concerns that I have are with state government and the legislature.
Mine too, but we'll listen to your question there.
Thank you. I am concerned about the voucher system, because my understanding, and you correct me please if I'm wrong, is the money stays with the student. So wherever the student is attending, the money goes to that school because it's where the student goes. That they were looking at a large amount of money going to homeschooling, which, you know, there are some parents that are excellent homeschoolers. They really make sure that their children learn. Others let them watch TV, whatever. The other part of that is vouchers for private schools. I can tell you that my parents paid tuition for me and my brothers and sisters, 7 of us, to attend Catholic school. Now, we got a rigorous education there. It was excellent. but that was my parents' sacrifice. It wasn't the taxpayers that paid for that. And I think that that if we want, if children want to attend, their parents want to sacrifice for them to attend private schools, I'm all for that. But it should be the parents and the family's sacrifice. Maybe that means they don't have as many color TVs. Maybe that means they don't have as many cell phones or can't go out to eat as often. But it is their responsibility, not the responsibility of the taxpayers. Get to it. What are the schools doing to push back against this misguided use of state funds?
Good question, and Mary, I would agree with you. I think being a public school advocate and a member, I have conversations and I communicate with my representatives, and they know my position on the voucher systems and public dollars going to private school funding. We're trying to have those conversations consistently with them. I understand that particular bill may not have made it out of the funnel this week or two ago. Anything can happen. It can be brought up any given time. There will be an excessive amount of dollars that will be needed to, in fact, send with those children if they do go to private school. And it could be a hot button issue. I don't think that issue's gone away yet. I think really what has to happen is everybody in the room here who are really passionate about public education have to, in fact, talk to your representatives, talk to your senators, let the governor, whether it be Ms. Reynolds and or Governor Branstad, and let them know that it's we don't believe it's right to take those public funds and allow parents any opportunity or choice to go to a parochial private school. The school already gets it's less than half, but like 3% or 4%, I'm sorry, 30%, 40% of the monies that a normal student would go. So if we offer opportunities for those homeschool students, they can dual enroll, they can send their kids to our school for activities. We do get compensated somewhat for that. That does help. But the school already provides public dollars to help our local Christian school. We provide dollars for busing. It's our folks who will go into the Christian school, and for Title I dollars and for other reasons, and Mike could speak to this more effectively, but we work with the Christian school already. And so it's not like they're not getting some of those dollars. But you're right. I think really what has to happen, the public, and I think across the state, the majority of Iowans believe just what you said, that it's not right, it's not that time to take public dollars to give to parents. The bill that, or there was the bill that eventually I don't think got out of the committee, I think would have allowed that, and it was. I mean, it's tough when it comes to. How do you voice your opinion and let the legislature know that this is something that Iowa simply does not want? Part of the issue I have with the public funds going to private is those private schools will always have the ability to say, we don't want this child. So whether that child is a special ed child, whether that child is a behavior problem, whether that child can't shoot baskets well enough, whether that child is not smart enough to be on the robotics team, they can say, we don't want them. And what's going to happen is they're going to be able to cherry pick and choose what kids they want coming into their school and what kids they don't want. Well, we know where the kids where they don't want are going to go. They're going to come to us, our public schools. Mm-hmm. All right. And so there are so many other reasons that I could give you, but I'll leave it at that for right now. And I thank you for your comments, because that is an issue that we're going to have to be aware of not only this year, but next fall and spring as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Jane Kozlerich, and I live here in Oski. I want to thank you, gentlemen, for taking the time to come up here and talk to us today. I heard a lot of positive things. Glad I stuck around. I just rode up with my husband for him to post the colors, but I'm glad I stuck around because I learned quite a bit, good things about our district that I didn't know. And then, after I stood in line all that time, the lady ahead of me asked some of the same questions I had planned, and you've answered them partially. It was about homeschooling. I'm glad to hear we're out of debt. And so, Russ, I heard you say that. My question was, One, do we get credit money-wise from the state for the homeschooled children? And I heard you say if they come in for activities, we do get partial money, but are they dollars that we're losing when they homeschool?
Are they dollars that we're actually losing? No. As soon as a family comes, if their family is in our district and they want to homeschool, there's two different types of homeschooling, and this can get really confusing here, so bear with me. Feel free to call me on Monday and I can explain it in very good detail if necessary. But the homeschooling, if they come to our school and they register as homeschool students, we will in fact get some money. It's like, yes, we get $2,000 maybe of the $2,200 of the $6,600 that we would get. And because of that, then we will offer services. They may not take them, but we offer services. And that could be textbooks, that could be an opportunity to work with our staff. At the high school level, they could take a college class through maybe Indian Hills. And if they want to participate in sports and dual enroll, then they can participate with activities. They could, at fourth and fifth grade, be involved in orchestra and band and do that all the way through the high school. So we do get some of those monies for them. What we're looking at doing with Oskaloosa this year is, in fact, I'm going to be making some phone calls and setting up interviews. We are actually going to start a homeschool assistance program, and that program where we have actually hired an individual to come in and work, what we're looking at doing is maybe expanding that. We have a large number of people and families in our district who open enroll their kids to Eddyville, Blakesburg. A couple will open enroll to North Mahaska because they already have that assistance program. We've just allowed parents to homeschool. It's the assistance program that you have to have and hire an individual to work with those families directly. We think we can offer more. We know we can offer robotics programs. We can offer an outstanding choir program. We know we can offer orchestra and band and great activities. So in fact, higher level classes. We can offer the chemistries, the Chem 2, the physics, calculus, high level math classes, science classes that maybe the districts around us can't. So we believe that if by starting this program, many of those parents might decide, you know what, Oskaloosa has more to offer. We're not going to open enroll out anymore. We're simply going to work directly with the Oskaloosa Homeschool Assistance Program, and we'll see what happens this spring. You know, if we can get 30, 40 additional kids coming back to our district and work with those families, we think that's a good thing for our community.
Good. Thank you. The other half part of my question was, why do we have so many parents choosing to take their kids out of our classrooms where we have the trained educators to do it on their own?
Yeah, and that's a good question, and it's something that our board and I have tackled. We've actually sent out surveys. There are a number of reasons. I don't know if there's any specific one reason. The homeschool assistance program did take a large number of kids out of our district, and they went to Eddyville and or North Mahaska. We hope to get some of those back. A number of parents in our survey had mentioned that, well, my job is at Cargill, or my job is over here. It's easier for me to drop my child off. They can go to school, might get off work, I pick them up. So it was all across the board. Several of the comments were about the elementary is just too big. I don't like hearing that, but if that's the reality we have to deal with, then what do we do next? I have made it a conscious effort when I first came, and we've still stayed with that, to make sure our class sizes in the elementary remain low. Our priority at the primary school, I think my first year here, we were looking at potentially 23 to 24 kids per class. We've dropped that down to 18, 19, and even below 20 at the K level, and I think Jolene can correct me. We've added classrooms. We added two teachers right before school, a day before school started last year, to simply try to make sure our class levels were down in that 22 to 24 range at levels 3, 4, and 5. With those cuts, that's been a priority. We have not taken those class sizes and at the primary level and gone 22 to 24. Many districts around us have done that. So, you know, going back to what Mrs. Hurston said earlier about our priority, that has been one of the big ones because we want to maintain those class sizes at the elementary to keep them very, very small. Those individuals who walk through that building at lunchtime, it can be overwhelming. We all know that. Those individuals who walk down those hallways, poke their head in those classrooms with 18, 19 kids at the kindergarten and first grade level and well below 23, 24 in some of the other classrooms at the upper levels, they understand and they see that's a great ratio and that school is not too big. So, thank you.
Hi, Teresa Grayheck, Oskaloosa, Iowa. I came this morning hoping to hear relief for the teachers that they can trust you. I didn't hear that today. I don't feel that. It's great to hear that we're in the black. But what are we, how can we make them our priority? I hear you say that our kids, that's your number one priority. They're our product from these teachers here who have raised our children. They should be our number one priority, because if we do not have a good staff, our kids are not coming out as great products. And I just challenge you to get them to trust you and to have the communication that they need. Why haven't we assured them, we gotcha, we are taking care of you? I've asked them, they've come, they said, we're looking because we're afraid. So what are we doing to assure them that we want them here, we protect them, we are gonna do everything we can, like the other 50% of the school districts that have done that?
Great question, and people may be tired of me talking. I can hand this time. But Teresa, you're right. I think it was back on February 17th, there's a Thursday, Friday, that I went around to each of the, to the buildings, and I said, Chapter 20 has been passed, it's been signed, here are the issues. Here's how it's gonna change the landscape. I've made on several occasions, we are going to do the very best we can to take care of the staff. The board values you. Well, exactly. A lot of times when we negotiate, we don't get done with negotiations until June or late May, June. I think there's a commitment among the board to do it as soon as possible. We are going to meet with the teachers again on April 10th. We hope to have a board meeting on April 11th. It's my hope that on April 11th that we have something that we can go to the board and say, yes, we agree with this and we can do this. We've been working passionately hard on the primary issue right now is health insurance. It really is. Certified staff members, many others throughout our district, and including me, all right, have a full paid family health insurance plan. How can we lower that cost? One of the things we're looking at doing is providing more options to our staff. So not only are we gonna have just a single and a family, we wanna give them prior or give them opportunities to say, if it's only you and your spouse, let's provide a plan for single or an employee spouse. Let's provide a plan for employee independence. So if your husband or wife's got a position and a job somewhere in the community and they have insurance offered to them, why would they have to remain on ours? They could take that and maybe we can lower that premium by $300-$400. If it is a family plan, how can we then look to reduce that overall cost? Because if we pay $1,500, $1,600 a month for every employee on a family plan, we think we can save some pretty good money. Currently, we are partial self-funding. It was a decision made a couple years ago to try and reduce that premium a little bit. The board at this time has taken a commitment. We are spending the difference from the $500 and $1,000 deductible, I need some water here a second, up to $2,000 and $4,000. So we can drop that premium significantly by $100, $200. The board is actually having conversations, and we've talked with our providers. What happens if we go to $4,000 and $8,000 on that partial self-funding commitment, which it would even drop the premium even further? Chad Vink and I have actually even talked to the insurance agents about dropping it to $6,000 and $12,000. And if we go to $6,000 and $12,000, who's taking the risk? That's the district. I mean, we potentially could lose $1 million a year on health insurance if we have a bad year. But those are the things that we're looking at, trying to do, so that we can come back to the teachers and say, it may not look like what it did last year, but you now have an option. Maybe it's just you and your spouse. Maybe it's just you and your dependents, because your spouse can get insurance. And this is the way it works in the business world. And I know this is the reason why our legislator has done this. And so those are some of the things that we have done, and I've talked to members of our quality circle about that. But I don't want to get too close and too far into negotiations, because, it's negotiations. It's between the association, it's between the board, and who we have hired to negotiate for us. We'll continue to work together. I firmly believe that the product we end up with and we can give back to the staff will be very sound and be very good. But until negotiations are over with, I really can't come out and just say, here's what we're going to give, here's what we're going to ask you to pay for your insurance. And in fact, you know, here are the different plans. We do and are scheduling a health insurance time period or commitment on sometime late April. I'll get with the staff and the teachers, the bus drivers, everybody, and bring everybody in. We plan on making sure if we can figure out specifically what we want to do, here's what we're going to offer, here's how it affects you, and hopefully, we're still hoping a large percent, 90% better, will not have to pay for health insurance.
How do you alleviate their fears?
I don't know how, other than a board member myself saying we are doing everything we possibly can.
Are you saying it?
Yeah.
We're doing everything we possibly can. I've been in school buildings for 6 years volunteering a great deal of my time. I care. I would love to vote on a contract agreement on our April 11th board meeting. I would love to do that, okay? If it's agreed upon April 10th between the sides representing the association and the group representing the board, I can't control that. Those people make that decision when they meet. It's extremely important that we have high morale. I don't want anything to change that. I also do not want to have a cheap health insurance program. For a lot of people, I'm very lucky my children are healthy. There are people that rely on the health insurance program as a critical part of their family's existence. I do not want to leave those folks with a cheap health insurance program that leaves them in a real bind, because there are people that rely on them greatly. It's not a thing that we get an overnight quote on what does it cost for these different health insurance programs with different deductibles. These things take time. We're talking about a few million dollars in premiums, to be quite serious about it. I do not want to rush into something of that size. I am committed to this school district for our kids and for our teachers. We're doing everything we can do it as quickly as possible. We're talking almost daily on some of these things. We're having updates from Mr. Ryder to the board on things. We had one yesterday regarding the potential cost of this insurance. It's extremely important, but it's also extremely important that we do not rush through it. So I would love to see an agreement April 11th if the groups that meet on that April 10th bring that to us. Does that help? If it doesn't, I'd like...
You're talking about a morale issue, and you do say that you're in the schools a lot, so you do realize the morale issues that we're having. I mean, they're sinking, and you heard it today. I mean, it's scary. And we
it's
have
scary.
Phenomenal
I've been
teachers.
In the boat. In 2001, I was in a similar situation with a child yet to be born. I know what it feels like. If there's something more that I can do to tell people, I have an email address, I have a phone number. People don't contact me about those things much. But there's my statement. I'd love to vote on it in April.
And just a final statement, there's no way we can guarantee and make a comment that nobody's health insurance is not going to be affected, because it will be. And I will tell you, mine is as well. I've already had conversations with the board. Whatever we decide is not only for certified staff, and how it affects the support staff, but administrators as well. I'm in the same boat. Are my high school, or my principals, high school, middle school, whomever it is, we're going to be right there with them, incurring the same cost. We're going to have the same options. How does that affect us? We need to provide more options. We need to provide, and as far as the school taking on a greater risk, it's going to happen in some capacity. So we are bearing some of that brunt, but I don't have anything outside of we're doing everything we can to minimize the effect of the health insurance issue.
Thank you.
Okay, that gets us to the end of our time this morning. I'm going to offer one last chance for any closing comments, gentlemen.
I guess the only thing I would say is,
are you willing to give up some time?
Sure.
Yes.
It's Joyce.
Thank you. This is not from the OEA. Since I'm an officer, I want to make sure that you know it's from me. Do you have a timeline for when the handbook will be made? Can you tell me for sure that our handbook will be made before you ask me to sign a contract?
I would say yes. I hate to say there are no guarantees in life. But once we decide upon our insurance and our salary, whatever negotiated issue comes out, The items that make up that handbook will be a great deal of what was in the previous contract. We're going to take those items. We're going to move them over. We do want we understand that employees are going to want to know what they're going to have to work under, what are the work rules. We don't see any great major changes at all. There may be a minor thing here. There may be an issue here. But ultimately, our goal is to make sure that what they see today, how they go to work, when they go to work, when they leave work, all of those issues we don't think are going to change, and if there are, they're very minuscule. So the goal is to have something in the handbook so that, yes, by the time they're required to sign off on that 21 days after being handed the option, that they in fact do, and they have that handbook to look at. It may be mid-May. Whenever.
I don't care when it is.
Right.
I just want to know.
Yeah, we're not going to. We are not waiting for the summer by any means, because that is another drastic change in how we will be doing business next year. So, very good question. Thank you, Joyce.
Okay. So anyway, closing comments.
There will be 100 comments. I mean, there'll be 100 more questions, and that's fine. Send me an email. Give me a phone call. If you are a staff member and you've got some time in the morning or mid-afternoon, at night, please send me an email. I'll answer them the best I possibly can. I would like to say send them all to the board members as well, but I'd like to see you come to me first and then go to your board members. If there is a complaint, if there's just comments, I have no problem with you guys talking at all. That's not an issue. But thank you so much for being here this morning. I'm willing to take whatever questions you have, whether it be yet to that or this morning, tomorrow, Wednesday. Dr. Tom. Tom?
I just want to thank everyone for being here. We want to be transparent. We want to get questions and answers to people as quickly as possible on all of these different topics. There's just so many things that we have to do within the school district. We have limited funds. I don't want to see reductions. I want to do everything we can for the kids with the same programs we have in place now. And we want to share that information as best as possible. So like Mr. Ryder said, please keep the questions, calls, emails coming in, and I want to make sure you get the answers that you deserve. Thank you.
Jane, don't leave. I have some information about homeschooling I want to share with you. Other than that, thanks everybody. I appreciate all the support at the elementary. We are blessed, and I truly believe that. Whisper, talk to your neighbors, talk at church and other community organizations, and if you so desire, we would love to have the help and encourage you to come help us at the elementary. Many hands make light work. Our kids love the morning breakfast time, coming and visiting and getting to know our kids and building those relationships with our community. So thank you.
Okay. And so once again, we want to acknowledge the free coffee that was provided by Midwest One. We want to thank and it was good coffee, again. We also want to thank Smokey Row for providing this venue. We also thank the coverage of Oskaloosa News, the Oskaloosa Herald, KBOE Radio, KIIC Radio, the New Sharon Sun, and CRI. And in closing comments, I'm the mayor of Oskaloosa, have been. This is year number 8 for me. I really appreciate this type of a venue where people can come and respectfully say what's on their mind, and that the listening that goes on, that Oskaloosa is a truly unique community where there's a significant amount of respect for the different perspectives that are brought, and also the understanding that everyone can win if we communicate well with each other and work towards common goals. And so Eggs and Issues, I think, is one of the things I can point at and say this is what makes Oskaloosa truly special. So on behalf of everyone who worked on Eggs and Issues, I thank you for being an exceptional part of it as well. And with that, we finish up Eggs and Issues for the year. Thank you again.